main connection with the machine is the throttle. And too much throttle and the wheel spins, and not enough throttle and the bike stalls.
It's a very friendly sport, and everybody knows everybody else. I think the fact that it's not expensive, and I think motorcycles anywhere, whether it be at the Scott Trial here or the TT, I think they always have an attraction to people, maybe even more than cars. I think probably because it's nearer to the man in the street's pocket more than anything else. Enthusiasm counts for a lot, and it's the one sport I would say left where if a man has got this ability at a young age, he can go out and buy one of these machines that anybody else can buy. And if he has this ability, he will ride as well as your best professional.
Spanish bikes like the Montesa, Ossa and Bultaco have dominated the Scott Trial ever since the great British rider Sammy Miller was bought by Barcelona. The Japanese are just starting to make their presence felt. But it's 15 years since a British manufacturer won, and this time the BSA name appeared on only two of the 176 starters.
Say, I'll promise to pay the bearer, does it?
No, it doesn't.
Right, Chalky, what number?
Three.
Nick Jeffries, youngest son of a famous father, would retire with a dislocated shoulder. What did he think of the Scots?
Exhausting. Yeah, it goes on for a long, long time. Longer than the other trial, I should think. For a one-day trial. It's great fun. It's exciting, hairy. Handstands. Well, it's a good day out.
Time, sir, yes.
Half an hour after the start, Orgate Falls. 50 yards of slippery boulders spanning a fast-flowing stream. A special section observed by marshals, where putting a foot down or just dabbing the ground loses marks riders can't afford this early in the 65-mile trial. Peter Remington, John Bailey, John Horsfall and Stanley Willis cross without too much trouble. But an early casualty was Stan Simpson, number 24, doing the Scott for the first time. He stalled in a cloud of steam. On an open stretch of moor between Orgate Falls and Cold Knuckles, Alex Shannon has a puncture. He looks down at the back wheel, slewing the bike sideways. Weeks of rain had turned the far straights on top of the moor into little more than a bog. Trevor Braithwaite picks his way across the clumps of moss and into a gully. Mick Andrews, Yamaha's Big Hope, had a bad day. He crashed with a flat tire, then was excluded for missing one of the observed sections. It was a bitter blow to his British Championship ambitions. Out of 53 newcomers to the Scott, John Metcalf was judged the best. He was also the highest placed competitor on a Japanese bike, riding his Suzuki into 11th place in a marathon event crowded with experienced veterans. It was a clear, sunny day, the best weather the Scott had seen for years. But the ground was so waterlogged that the first man to reach Fagger Gill after 90 minutes of the trial was over half an hour late. Fagger Gill, 100 yards of rocks and water 2 feet deep, had been cleared of twigs and branches, but big tree trunks still lay across the course. Andy Gill got his Montesa well and truly stuck on the biggest of them all. Whoever plotted this course is either a potholer or a mountain goat. That's what John Hemingway, number 61, said after overtaking 60 riders who'd started in front of him. Alex Shannon in trouble again in a cloud of steam and smoke. Clive Smith has a fall, but he's struggling with a broken wrist. Fagger Gill may look a peaceful stretch of woodland, yet it turns out to be a watery grave for beginners and the experts. Ray Smith flies through a farmer's gate with a sign to beware of the bull, but worse hazards are ahead. This is the tank trap, so named after the first man to split his tank and spill petrol all over the rocks. Jack Galloway gets up okay, but after him, John Hemingway has to walk it, and Clive Smith, still with that wrist injury, goes down once again. After the tank trap, a steady climb to tackle the razor-like rocks at Tottergill and the Funnel. Then a major obstacle, Grand Canyon, which lives up to its infamous reputation. Winner in 1959 on a BSA, Jeff Smith, back from Canada, showed how the canyon should be done, though he hasn't done the Scott for 5 years. This year, the tricky section through the Black Boulders gave less trouble than the climb up, where the muddy path was as slippery as glass. The yellow pennants, 4,000 of them in all, led on to Surrender, a short sprint up a hilly stream. This is Ken Raw's little X-Works BSA, one of only two British bikes in the event failing it. The observer's card is the clue to the Scott competitor's main problem. Should he try and clean a section feet up at speed and risk the odd boulder stopping him? Penalty, 5 marks. Or deliberately put a foot down just once to keep going and be penalised only 1 mark.
To ride a trials bike properly on rough ground, it's not like a road bike. One has to stand up on the pedals to get the proper balance. And if you can think about standing up for 65 miles on the pedals, going as fast as you can, which you have to do on this particular trial, it's a long distance motocross event if you want, and the whole bike is bucking and swaying, you've got to steer it down narrow tracks and over rocky ground. This is where the fatigue comes in.
Montesa manager Mike Wood knows the score. Fatigue, falling on rocks, the wet and the cold. What else must the successful trialist learn to live with? What's the trick, for example, of handling these highly bred two-stroke bikes at low speed in deep water? Mick Andrews.
Throttle control, balance, but not static balance, like balance in motion, and being able to find grip, and being able to read the observed sections you're riding through, being able to pick the path.
Picking a path at Storthwaite, Bill Wilkinson, a very old hand at the Scott. It doesn't do him much good. But after losing his tank and his seat near Underbanks, he did take home the Veterans Award. Next man up, Clive Smith, gets it right. But few did on this 200-yard ascent up half a dozen waterfalls. Lampkin also checks the course with care. Despite punctures in both tyres, he'd end up the day third overall. And, more important, the rider losing least marks on observed sections, like this tortuous test at Storthwaite. Eddie Smith from Trawden hurts his hand. Apart from a broken wrist and a sprained shoulder, no major injuries marred the Scott. But bruises and blisters were unavoidable in the hours of brutal battering over rocks and rubble. Martin Lampkin takes a penalty by missing the steepest of the waterfalls. Despite a puncture near the finish, he'd miss winning the Scott by only 2 marks. But with second place, he came very close to achieving his greatest ambition. And with brother Alan Lampkin third, it was a great Yorkshire family double. Fastest time, 4 hours, 38 minutes, 21 seconds, was Malcolm Rathmell, despite ugly blisters on both hands. He never wears gloves, says it's like washing your feet with socks on. Rob Edwards, captain of the Montesa team, allows himself to be helped round the rapids. The number 164, peeling off his bike, was to prove very lucky indeed. Apart from a cut on his shin, caused by a rock chipping coming through his boot, Rob's only trouble with the bike was replacing a chain. He said it was the most enjoyable Scott he had ever ridden in. Dave Thorpe from Bronfield did very well at Storthwaite. There was some confusion about his points at some sections because of a muddy number plate, but in the final results for the best performance overall, he was placed sixth. Thorpe's anxiety, waiting for the muddle to be cleared up, underlines the special character of the Scott. The outright winner is not necessarily the fastest. The trophy goes to the rider who loses the least marks in terms of speed and his performance on the special sections. Competitors choose whether to go flat out, regardless of footing in the observed sections, or to concentrate on the clever stuff through the streams and rocks and pay a penalty in time. The same man can win on both counts, but it's very rare. It was a wonderful day for the Scot. The sun shone almost to the finish. On the top, despite a soaking from weeks of rain, the action was superb. Yorkshiremen dominated the entry, as they've done ever since the trial was first run in 1914. And in this Diamond Jubilee year, thanks to 50 farmers who provide the land, there were record crowds buying programmes and so helping charities like the local hospital. Amazingly, there were no stretcher cases at Roy's Rocks, a real killer. An incredible balancing act among giant boulders, sorting out the men from the boys. The way home was uphill and down dale, through farmland and then to Roan House, a deep defile in bleak moorland about an hour from the finish. By now, the backmarkers were very late. Some had taken all day to cover 30 miles. Tiredness was the worst thing. When they fell, many didn't want to get up, but they were cheerful enough. So what began as a works outing for the employees of a Shipley motorbike firm founded by Alfred Scott survives today as this supreme test of skill on two wheels. North countrymen dominate this event, and local knowledge of the rocky going isn't the only reason. It's a matey occasion. Broad accents from both sides of the Pennines are as much a part of the Scott trial as the smell of baked mud on a cylinder barrel. Finally, there's the stunning landscape of Swaledale itself. When you come off the moor and wind your way down the escarpment towards the little stone grey town of Reith, you're very much aware that this part of North Yorkshire is just about the best kind of English countryside there is. The finish, where the winner, the runner-up and Mike Wood summed up the Scott's fascination. First, we asked the second man, Alan Lampkin, if this year's Scott had been the worst.
No, it's been raining a lot, you know, for the last few months.
Where did you find it wettest?
It's wet all the way around, on top.
Do you think your times are better this year or worse?
Couldn't tell you. What? I haven't got a clock on, look.
What is it about the Scott trial that you like and enjoy?
It's a man's trial. Oh, that's Sunday outing.
I don't know, it's rather like banging your head on a brick wall. It's nice when you stop, but it's a sense of achievement, isn't it? Some people climb mountains and other people ride motorbikes.
The one thing about this particular event, the Scott, is you had 200 young riders, if you want, who are unleashed at one-minute intervals on reliable machines and can really let themselves go with no restrictions. The police aren't there to hinder them or anything else, and they can enjoy themselves.
105, 109 total.
The Alfred A. Scott Memorial Trophy was awarded that night at the King's Head Hotel in Richmond to 28-year-old Rob Edwards. He had a nasty gash in his leg and a score of over 100 marks, which proved how tough the trial had been. It was the first time this Middlesbrough clubman from Thornaby-on-Tees had won the Scott, and the second time this 60-year classic had been won on a Montesa. Rob also took the prize for the best performance by a Yorkshireman. No wonder it was a popular victory.
Would you believe me if I said I can't believe it? It's fantastic, absolutely. I can't believe that I've actually done it. I think my best previous to this has been fourth, and to win it, well, that's my life's ambition, and that's it, so thanks a lot. As soon as anybody mentions that they're a motorcyclist, everybody immediately thinks they've got leather jacket with studs in and a 750 motorcycle. I think trialing is set apart from that. It's man against the elements. It's a chance to get out in the open air, in the fresh air every week. And if I don't ride on a Sunday, I'm thoroughly miserable, you know.